Of my actual review PDF is miscellaneous proofs. So let's just do some miscellaneous proofs. Let A be an integer where A is equivalent to 1 mod 3. I want to prove A to the third is equivalent to 1 mod 9. All right. That's a 3. So we're going to use a direct proof for this. So since A is equivalent to 1 mod 3, we can say let A equal 3n plus 1 where n is an integer. That's just like the definition of, you know, being divisible by 3, you know? All right, well, then A to the third is equal to 3n plus 1 to the third. Right, that's just what we made in order to multiply it to the third. So if you FOIL that out, I'm going to skip that. Hopefully you'll know how to FOIL twice. That's 27n to the third. Plus 27n squared plus 9n plus 1. All right. So this is sort of the most interesting step here. If we notice that these three are divisible by 9, right? 27, 27, of course, 9. So if we factor out 9, we'll get 3n to the third plus 3n squared plus n. All plus 1. And then, of course, we can say, we can replace all of this with an integer and get 9c plus 1, where c is equal to 3n to the third plus 3n squared plus n. So clearly, c is an integer, right? Because we defined n to be an integer and we've only done like integer things to it. So therefore, we can say, by like the definition of mod, we can say that a to the third is equivalent to 1 mod 9. That'd be the end of the proof. Any questions? Please speak up if you do have questions, because I don't know if my review will last 2 hours if you don't. Okay, everyone's good on this, and that's good. All right, so next, let's prove. It's got one with sets. Prove A subset B and A subset C implies A is either the empty set or B intersect C is the empty set. Okay? So prove that if A is a subset of B and A is a subset of C, then either A is the empty set or B and C don't intersect at all. Okay? So, Dr. Galino specifically asked me to cover different proofing techniques. So you notice I did a direct proof last time. So this time I'm going to do a proof by contradiction. All right? So to do a proof by contradiction, we have to assume the opposite of what we're trying to prove. So we'll assume A is the empty set, or B intersects C is the empty set. We'll just assume the opposite of that. Okay? All right, so if we distribute that that not, we'll get A is not the empty set, and B intersects C is the empty set. All right, so we're assuming that A is not empty and B and C do have an intersection, okay? All right. So since A is not empty, then let's let X, just some variable X, be an A, all right? So since we're assuming this and the original premise, we can say also that, of course, X is an element of B, right? Because if A is a subset of B, then if we take anything from A, then it's also going to be in B. And we can also say that X is in C. Okay? What was that? Oh, yeah. Yeah, you're right. My bad. Thank you. Well, if you distribute this not, this equals becomes a not, this or flips and becomes an and this not on the equals, if we just make that an equals, then that's the opposite of the original statement. So that's De Morgan's going on here. Any more questions? Okay. All right. So if we've got X in A, X in B, X in C, since we've got X in both of these, that means that, of course, X has to be in B intersect C, right? Well, if X is in B intersect C, then how the heck can B intersect C be empty? So that's it. That's our contradiction. All right, and we could say that this implies B intersects C is not equal to the empty set, which contradicts our assumption here. Therefore, the original statement is correct. Any questions? All right. Oh, so X is an A, all right? So first we say, okay, so A is not empty, so it has something in it. Let's pick some random thing from it, call it X, all right? So from this premise, it has to be in B, and it has to also be in C. Okay. Good question. Thank you. Anything else? All right. So now let's prove for all R, comma S in the positive real numbers, so we're taking all possible combinations of R and S that are positive real numbers. Let's prove that R times S is greater than, being greater than 100 implies that R is greater than 10, or S is greater than 10. All right, so let's prove this by prove it by contraposition. Since we did direct proof and contradiction before, let's just do a different technique, okay? So let's assume okay. So we're assuming the opposite of the premise of the solution, that what we're trying to prove. All right. So first of all, we got R less than or equal to 10. All right. If we multiply both sides by S, we get. Okay. Simple enough. We're getting somewhere. We take the other one, S less than or equal to 10, multiply both sides by 10. Okay. All right. So we've got SR is less than or equal to 10S, and 10S is less than or equal to 100. So since these are the same, we can just sort of eliminate that, and we'll get SR being less than or equal to 100. I'll use RS. Because less than or equal to is transitive. There's a key word you learned recently. Okay? So what we've proved here is the opposite of the premise, right? So since that makes the contrapositive true, therefore the original statement must be true. So what we've done, we've proven well, let me use this instead. Not. So we've just proven like the reverse opposite of the original statement. That's what proof by contrapositive is. Any questions? Okay. Well, we're like 30% of the way through, and we're only 15 minutes in, so this is not good. Hopefully you've all got tons of questions for me at the end, like at least an hour and a half's worth of questions. All right. So the last of my miscellaneous proofs. All right. So I heard from a few people that come to my sessions that there was a question like this on the last exam, and they hated it. So I'm going to do a problem like this. So find the 10th term in the expansion of 10 plus 3 to the 12. Okay. So you know, like, if you expand this, you'll get, like, a polynomial where the first term is going to be something to the 12, and the last term is going to be a constant. and you'll have all those terms in between. Well, what's the 10th one? So you were given this formula. It's in the slides, but I'll write it again. It's called the binomial formula. X plus y to the n, so we've got x plus, where y is 3 and n is 12. That's equal to the sum from I equals 0 to n of n choose I times x to the n minus I. Let's plug in for these variables. Okay, so we know that n equals 12, y equals 3, x equals x still. These are all the formulas in the original thing. So should we just plug all of these into this summation and get us the entire expansion? No, that'd be silly, right? But we only want the 10th term. Why find out the entire expansion? There's a shortcut we can do that will just give us the 10th term. Okay, okay. So, good observation. Notice the indexing starts at 0. So, if we were asked to find the first term, we would want to find the term where I equals 0, right? To find the second term, we would plug in. If we just solve this alone, this is like its own subformula in the whole thing. So if we figure out what value I would have. So like what I was saying, if we wanted to find the second term, we would plug in I being 1 because the indexing of the summation starts at 0. So in this case, I will actually be 9. That makes sense to everyone? All right, good. Okay, so then let's just plug them into a formula. And you get a formula sheet, right, on your exam. Also get a calculator on your exam, so I'm not going to go through how all that junk turns into this. Oh, it's y is 3. In the original, we had x plus 3. Boy, I had way more misunderstandings proofs than I thought. Okay. But we're still plugging up them, but. Alright, any questions on this? Yeah. I equals 9? Okay. So let's say we wanted to find let's just do this for the first like two terms or something. So let's just do this whole summation for the first two terms. So that'll be x plus 3 to the 12 equals the sum from I equals 0 to 12 of 12 choose I, x to the 12 minus I, 3 to the I, all right? So the first two terms in that expansion will be where I equals 0. So we have 12 choose 0. The next term, which will be 12 choose 1,
x to the 12 minus 1 plus 3 to the 1 plus dot dot dot. All right? So there's going to be, 13 terms in this whole expansion? So the first term is this one, right? Can everyone agree on that? This is the first term. This is the second term. All right. So for the first term, notice that I is 0. So it's 1 less. For the second term, I is 1. Again, it's 1 less. So the index, there's a bit of an indexing mismatch. It's off by 1. So if you want the 10th term, I for the 10th term will be 9. Okay? Everyone good on that? Okay. I would challenge you to find a general formula. You would start with this for the kth term. Well, the y variable isn't removed, it's the 3 instead. X plus. In this case, the y is 3 over here. Yeah? Yeah, you could. And you would. You should have 5 raised to the 12, yeah. Into, this solution? Well, that's because this is specifically the 10th term in this expansion. It's not the full expansion of this whole formula. This is just the 10th term. This expands into 13 terms. Thanks for pointing that out, though. So, yeah, if you wanted to solve this for this being 2 plus 3 to the 12, you could plug it into here. You should get, if you sum all the terms, you should get 2 plus 3 to the 12. Okay. Any more questions? Okay. What's a general formula for the kth term? That might be a good thing to know. And we probably have time to figure that out now. Yeah? I agree with K minus 1. Nice. So you just take this whole thing in dotted lines and just replace it with K minus 1. So that's going to be n choose K minus 1 x to the n minus k minus 1, y to the k minus 1. All right, that's the formula for the 10th term in a binomial expansion. Cool. Thank you. Yeah, that requires you to know it equals kth term in expansion of x plus y to the n. So you gotta know x, y, n, and k to do this formula. questions? Yeah. Minus 1, because the zeroth term is the first term. When I is 0, that's the first term. So if you just subtract. Yeah. This will be 12 minus 10 minus 1 will give us. Oh, yeah. That almost got us. Thank you. Okay. Everyone good? Okay. Cool. All right. So let's prove the following logical argument. And we want to prove for all x, r of x, and s of x. Okay? So who knows what rule we're going to have to use here? Something from your formula sheet. Of rules of inferences and stuff like that. There should be one that's just very obvious from the problem. There's something that we're going to have to use at some point. Does anyone have their formula sheet with them? Or something to look at the formula sheet? Oh, nice. Okay, so that's one resolution. We have that. What makes you think it'll be a resolution? Right, okay. Okay. Yeah. Okay. All right. I see where you're getting at. Yeah, we're going to have to use that at some point where you do something that fits just P of X on a line by itself. You know, saying that by itself is true. So, yeah, we're going to have to do that eventually. Good. Solid random. that. We're going to have to use modus ponens. But what's the first rule we're going to have to apply? It's a rule of inference. And it's on your formula sheet. That's what you were saying, resolution, but the name of the rule is actually simplification. So yeah, good. So you're both right. Yeah. Universal generalization. We're gonna have to use that. Why would we use universal generalization instead of instantiation or the existential ones? Generalization, you see it starts with P of C, and you can say it generalizes to for all P of X, right? That's how that one goes. What's instantiation? Is instantiation different? Okay, so instantiation is different because it starts with for all X, P of X, and that we instantiate it into a singular P of C. So what are we starting out with here? A for all X. So you'll see at the bottom of your formula sheet you have, let's see if this works. Oh boy, okay. So we've got four of these guys. First two are universal, they work on for alls. The second two are existential, they work on there exists. Alright, so in this case we've got a for all, so we're going to be worrying about these two. Alright, so just looking at this, the universal instantiation starts with for all x, and you instantiate it into a single P of C. Universal generalization says if we've got a P of C, we can generalize it to for all x, P of x. So what we've got going on right now is we're starting out with a for all x here, which is given. We need to instantiate that into a single instance C. So you can say P of C implies Q of C and R of C using one and universal instantiation. Right? Can be one four. Everyone good on that? So let's do the same to the second premise. Let's instantiate that. What's that going to become? Someone shout it out. P of C and S of C. Nice. All right, that's using 2 and again universal. That someone's already shouted out. Simplification, okay? Simplification. Let's just do P first because that comes first. We can say P of C, right? Using 4 and. Alright? And I typically like to simplify both terms. Even if I don't know if I'm going to need them both. Like to simplify them both just so you have them. Justin. I like that you can look ahead and see what rules are going to need. Yeah? Modus ponens. All right. How are we going to use modus ponens? Okay, nice. So we're going to use modus ponens here. So we got P of C. We know that implies P of C and R of C. So we can just say Q of C and R of C using 5, 3 modus ponens. Oh boy, what have I done? Cool. The modus ponens. What can we use now? What would be the best thing to do now? Remember, we're trying to get to R of X and S of X. Yeah? Conjunction? Okay, so how are we going to use conjunction? 6 and 7. So if we conjunct these, that would give us S of C and Q of C and R of C. Yeah? We can simplify what I just said or something else. Number 7? Okay. Yeah, we can do either or. You're right. Yeah, we can do either or. So let's simplify this first. What do you want to simplify out? We've got R of C, we've got S of C, and we're looking for R and S, so then we can just conjunct these. Right, so we know these are true individually, so obviously they'll be true together, that's how conjunction works. So that's using 8 and 6. It's the opposite of simplification, pretty much. Alright, step 10. This will be the final step. Universal generalization. Nice. I like how quickly I got that. All right. Any questions? Let's see, are step 5 and 6 necessary? Well, we needed P, right, so we could do modus ponens here, right? And we needed S so that we can conjunct that into R, right? So it turns out we did need both of them. Just do modus ponens. Oh, see, I'll just do modus ponens here because you could say we got P of C, so just skip the simplification step. I'd say some professors would allow that because, you know, simplification is kind of a nitpicky step, right? I mean, you wouldn't be totally wrong, but this is, of course, more explicit. Let's do every possible step to a T that we need. Any more questions? All right. Notice that the universal generalization and instantiation are basically just ways to take, we have a premise or something that's kind of for all, but we want to use all of our other tons of rules of inference and logical identities and stuff. So this is just a way to bridge us to a place where we can actually use those. All right. All right, so now I'm going to do the actual last one on my set of just miscellaneous proofs. 2, you can tell me what the natural numbers are really quick. All positive and negative numbers end 0. Wouldn't this be all integers? All positive integers and 0. Okay, that's where the natural numbers are. I had a question like this on one of my past reviews. So if you're wondering, like, what's integers, what's natural numbers and stuff, you can look at that review. I think that's my first review. Yeah. Alright, so it's a proof for all n and x are both natural numbers where x is greater than 2. Alright, so just a little bit extra on that. We need to prove that the sum of I equals 0 to the n of x to the I is less than x to the n plus 1. Okay? So if you were like computer calculus and stuff, you should go and look at that and just, you know, okay, well, obviously that's true. But we need to prove with induction. That's just what we've been assigned to do, so let's do that. All right, so what's the base case? What are we going to do induction on first? We've got to decide what variable we're going to do induction on. What variables do we have in here? X, N, and I. Okay, well, those are all the variables here, yeah? So I basically exists only in this summation. So we can't really do induction on it because the scope of this variable isn't in the whole problem. So that leaves us with just X and M. So which of these would it make sense to do induction on? Something out of your 50-50, you're going to be right. X? N. Okay. We need to do induction on M because induction is something you do like curvily over integers. X is basically constant in this whole, it's a variable, but it's like a constant variable. Its value sort of doesn't change. But here, N is used as the counter for I. So we're going to do induction on N, all right? What's our base case going to be? Who remembers base cases and stuff for induction? What's the possible values that N can be? All the natural numbers. What's the first natural number? 0. Base case is when n is 0. All right. Well, when n is 0, then we get the sum from I equals 0 to 0 of x to the I, which is obviously just x to the 0, which is just 1. And that needs to be less than x. 0 plus 1, which equals x, just x. So is 1 less than x? Because x is defined to be greater than 2. So obviously, if this is going to be, you know, greater than 2, then so the base case checks out. Alright? Now, we've proven it for n equals 0 instead of proving it just like we did here for n equals 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, up to infinity, which we obviously can't do because infinite ones, we use induction. So, the inductive hypothesis, we're going to assume for an arbitrary, oh no, it's my pen dying. My pen is dead. All right. assume for arbitrary n equal to k, which is a natural number, that just replace all the n's of k's in what we're trying to prove. The inductive step finally. Okay, so that is not easy to read, is it? Right, so now we need to prove for n equal to k. Can't see this either. Who has a pen I can borrow? Thank you. All right. I'm just going to rewrite all of this. So a lot of people think of the inductive hypothesis as like a totally useless step. Who kind of is like, why do we bother? Well, we just replace n with k, what's the point? Okay, so we got at least one person that is honest. Well, the thing is, so induction is like dominoes. The base case knocks over the first domino. But if we only have one domino, then we've just done something very sort of silly and just knocked over a table with one domino on it. But if we had like a line of dominoes, then we would just did something kind of cool. And maybe YouTube-worthy if we had like a cool design going on with them. So that's what the inductive hypothesis and inductive step are. Those are the extra line of dominoes. So K is some arbitrary, in that whole line of dominoes, K is, let's just pick some random U, this time like the kth domino. Then, the K plus one domino, the next domino, we're looking at that too. So we're just looking at that window and just two dominoes in this whole line. And if we can prove that, assuming that this first domino is like set up correctly, then it will knock over the second domino, the domino right after it, okay? So if we prove that for an arbitrary domino in the line, then we've basically proven all the dominoes in the line, and we've basically proven that the whole line of dominoes is well-formed, and when we knock over the first one, they'll all go down. That make sense to everyone? Okay. So we got to prove, assuming that we have this, we're assuming this is true, the inductive hypothesis, we need to prove the inductive step for the next domino. All right? start with the left-hand side. Okay, so we've got the summation from I equals 0 to k plus 1 of x to the I. That's equal to the summation from I equals 0 to k of x to the I plus x to the k plus 1. Everyone see what I did there? I just split the summation into two parts. I took every, this is still the summation from k, and then the last term is when we have k plus 1 being what I is. We just plug in k plus 1 from I and we get the last term. Everyone got on that? This is like, you know, almost all induction problems. They usually do a summation, you usually gotta split it. So this is something you gotta do. Okay? So does this look familiar to anyone? What is that? Is the line above it? Oh, of the assumption. Yeah, yeah, you're right. This is the inductive hypothesis. It's the first half of the assumption we made in the inductive hypothesis. Good. Alright? So we can say actually not equals, right? We're going to say less than, because this inductive hypothesis is less than. So if we replace this with the part second half of the assumption, x to the, oh no, what's that? Plus 1 plus x to the k plus 1, right? We can't say equals here, because we're replacing this with this, which we're assuming is greater than. So this whole thing becomes greater than. That's the thing you gotta watch out for with induction on inequality like this. You gotta know when to use equal to or greater than and stuff. Alright? Alright, well, this is obviously, these are just the same number, right? X to the k plus 1, x to the k plus 1, so that's just 2x to the k plus 1. Alright? Which equals x times x to the k plus 1. Alright, no. Which is less than, right? So that's kind of a creepy step. So from here to here is obvious, right? You just combine them together. But x is greater than 2, right? Right? Finally, an explanation for why, oh boy, that's finally an explanation for why x greater than 2 is in the premise. That's kind of kooky when you read that in the problem. Why x greater than 2, that seems kind of like a weird thing to throw in there. Well, this is why you need that in this step. So keep an eye out for information that might not seem useful, because usually it turns out to be useful, right here. That's just equal to x to the k plus 2. Everyone good on that and how these exponents work? Some people are kind of rusty since pre-talk, so they get tripped up on how that exponent happens. Any questions about induction or anything on this problem? Yeah, this less than sign has carried down, right? Because this is equal to the left-hand side is equal to this. It's less than this is equal to this. It's less than that is equal to that. So in this chain here, we've got less thans. So that means that you can just, you know, cross out all of this. At some point, we'll have to simplify this to this being less than this. Okay, good question. Yeah? Here? You're confused on that? Okay. So this part, x to the k plus 1, stays the same. All that's changed is instead of 2, we have x. Alright? So x is greater than 2. So we can say that we can replace that. We can just replace that 2 with an x and say that the resulting thing is greater. And we know that 2 is greater than x is greater than 2 because that was given to us in the description of the problem. So, yeah. That answer your question? Okay, good. Anything else? Do you have any questions? Okay, I think we're going to have time. I think I'm going to fill up the whole 2 hours. It's nice. I forgot about these like last 3 problems I had already. This is when I was really late and tired. All right, on to relations. All right. So, I've got like, let's see, what, 3, 4 problems where I just describe a relation and I ask, is it an equivalence relation, a partial order relation, or neither? So, partial order relations, if I remember correctly, correct me if I'm wrong, partial order relations won't be on your exam if you're in Dr. Bluness's class. But they're super simple, and like there's only one difference between them and equivalence relations. Mostly what he's not going over with partial order relations is the cool properties that they have, because equivalence relations have their own cool properties. So I'll just say what a partial order relation is. So an equivalence relation, first of all, what's an equivalence relation? Yeah. It's okay. So it's a relation that has to be reflexive, transitive, and symmetric. All right. And a partial order relation. Is almost the same thing. It's transitive. Let's see. Was it transitive and irreflexive? Yeah. Okay, it's reflexive. It's reflexive, transitive, and anti-symmetric. So it's just the same thing, but instead of symmetric, it's anti-symmetric. And described in your slides, there's all cool properties about equivalence relations. Not described in your slide is the cool properties of partial ordering relations. Who cares what those are? Pretty sure you're not going to test it on them. Unless it says in the slides you will be tested on them. With my knowledge, that's not on the slides. What I'm saying is that if I'm wrong, don't blame me about it being on the exam. Alright? So I'm going to give you some relations, and you've got to see if they're reflexive, transitive, symmetric, or asymmetric. And it helps to know what those definitions are, right? Who here can raise their hand and say with complete confidence that they know the exact definition of what reflexive relation is? We have one, and their hand is not even fully raised. So it'd be good to go over that really quick. A relation is if and only if, so that's like works both ways. If it's reflexive, you know that this over here that's blank is going to be true, and this thing over here that's blank. If that's true, then you know it's reflexive. So it works both ways. If for all A in big A, all right? So if you've got relation R that's over set A, it's reflexive if all the pairs of where both ordered pairs of the same value are in the relation. That makes sense for reflexive? When we do these will be like examples, and we'll see exactly how that works. You don't don't need to worry about it being something being irreflexive for, you know, partial ordering or equivalent relations, but let's list that anyway, because that might be on your exam too. So it's basically the same thing, except here, every ordered pair with both the same has to be in a relation. This is like the opposite. Every ordered pair that is the same, if that's in a relation, it's not irreflexive. The relation can't have a single pair that are both the same. Alright, symmetric. If for all A and B, then the set relation is over. Every combination of AB and A, if AB, A then B is in a relation, that means that B then A, so if the reverse, also has to be in a relation. Right? So that doesn't mean every possible combination of things in A, that just means of all the combination of things in A, the ABs, A then B, that's in R, the reverse also has to be in R. Okay? Should I say? First being reflexive? Okay. Let's double check that. I'm glad you're bringing that up. So let's see the slides. Where are the slides we'd be going over? Relations, probably the first slide of relations. Yeah, I understand your example. I just want to double check to make sure that's right. So just Googling irreflexive and going to the first page takes me to a Wolfram page. Let me zoom in so you can see this. All right. A relation R on a set S, so it's S instead of A, is irreflexive, provided that no element is related to itself. In other words, X relate R, same thing as XX being R, for no X. It's written differently, but that means the same thing as, okay? Yeah, it's not reflexive, you're right. Yes, this is not irreflexive. Correct. Well, this one's in here, so that means it can't be irreflexive. That's right. So you're saying that this set is irreflexive? Yeah, one's in there. element and this element weren't in the set, then it would be irreflexive. So these definitions I'm getting are from Dr. Arup Guha, the professor, he's not a doctor, Professor Arup Guha, who is, when Dr. Guha isn't teaching this grade, he's teaching this grade. He's been teaching this grade since like the late 90s. He's been teaching this grade for a long time. And his entire archive, if you just Google Arup Guha, Google his name, it'll probably be the first link that'll take you to his website, and you can find his archive, or I'll do that for you right now. Just Google Arup Guha, the first link, I spelled it wrong, let's see if I spelled it right, it's the first link, go to his archive, go to Intro to Discrete Structures down here. If you go to Lectures, on the side, he's got his past assignments, his past exams, past presentation problems, past optional problems, way back to spring 2000. So he's got lots of past material that you can go to and study with. If you go to his lectures, he's got his own lectures for all the stuff you've been learning. And they're all like in Word documents instead of PDFs. So his first one on relations, if you click on that, I've already got that downloaded. It's right here. His first form relations has all these definitions. So here's the definition for irreflexive. R is irreflexive if, for all A in big A, AA is not R. Exactly what I mean. One is in the relation. A is. Okay, yeah, it's the A, B, 1, 2, 3. Yes, 1 is an A. Yes. This means that this 1, 1 can't be in the relation. That means this is not an irreflexive relation. That this given relation is not irreflexive. It's still a relation, it just happens to be not reflexive and not irreflexive. They're not mutually exclusive. A relation can be one or the other or neither. If you take this relation and take out 1, 1, and 2, 2, now you've only got a relation of 1, 3, that's irreflexive. So it doesn't have a... What was that? If you take out the 1, it'd be the empty relation. That would be everything, I think. Yeah? it just, if it has, if every 1-1, every 2-2 stuff is in the relation, then it's reflexive. If it doesn't have any of them, then it's irreflexive. If it has some, but not all of them, it's neither. So that means a lot of relations are going to be neither. No. So this given set without the things crossed out is neither. It's not reflexive, and it's not irreflexive. It's only reflexive if every AA is in the set. So you have to have 1, 1, 2, 2, and 3, 3 for this to be reflexive. For it to be irreflexive, it can't have any of the ones. Yeah, they're not the same. They're not mutually exclusive. A set can be one or the other or neither. It can't be both. It's okay. Good. If you're super bent on using it, there exists. You could probably correct me if this is wrong. There does not exist A in A where AA is an R. Does that mean the same thing? So I think that means the same thing. Let's see. Yeah. So this might make more sense to some people. It might make more sense to you. So let's say if there exists an A in A and AA is an R, then that's not irreflexive. Okay? Is everyone good now? Okay. Because we probably would have had the same discussion over symmetric and anti-symmetric. It was sort of the same thing. Yeah, that's it. Yeah, your set, your three options are reflexive, irreflexive, or neither. Those are your three options. And it should be the same thing for antisymmetric. So let's look at antisymmetric. So symmetric was, if you've got A, B, and R, you have to have the reverse in the bottom. So this set, without the things crossed out, would that be symmetric? This set R be reflexive. It'll be symmetric. No. Because we have 1, 3 in here, but we don't have 3, 1. So therefore it's not symmetric. If you did have 3, 1, then it would be symmetric. Because it's also not like every single combination of A, B has to be in there. It's just of the ones that are in there, that makes it symmetric. This basically means is of all, so here it's symmetric. Of all the combinations of A and B, if AB is an R, the reverse has to be an R. So of all the combinations of A and B, you could pick A and B to be the same one. You could pick A to be 1 and B to be 1, right? Well, the reverse of that is just is also 1-1. So if 1-1's in the set, that implies 1-1 has to be in the set, and obviously it would be in the set, because, okay. So here, this is sort of saying, if you pick every random combination of A and B, if you have A, B, and R, and the reverse, B, A, that can only happen if you pick them both to be the same. So, yeah, basically, you can only have a set that's reflexive. If it's reflexive, then it's anti-symmetric. If it's reflexive, that doesn't mean it's anti-symmetric. But you can only have reflexive sets be asymmetric. Everyone get what I'm saying? I take this out, this set with any of these three, that's anti-symmetric. Because you have 1, 3, and you don't have 3, 1. That's the last one. All right. For all A, B, C in A, three variables, A, B being R, and B, C being R implies that A, C. So if you have AB and then BC, that means that AC is an R, okay? So it's sort of like saying, if I'm friends with you and you're friends with him, then I must be friends with him. That's just how friendship works, right? Obviously, that's not how friendship works. But if friendship were transitive, then that's how friendship would work, okay? All right, so now let's finally move on. Let's say we've got this relation. Let's define the relation R to be the set of order pairs AB such that AB are integers and A is equal to 3B. All right, so Z here, the integer, is basically like our A from before. So this is a relation on integers. And A has to be equal to 3B. Alright? So, is R reflexive? I got one head shake saying no. No. All right, why are you saying no? It can be what? Okay, so if A equals 3, then that means B has to equal, what, 9? So that means you got 3, 9 is an R, right? But 9, 3, so if you pick A to be 9, oh, yeah, you're right, my bad. One, three. So you pick A to be instead of 1, then B would have to be, if A is 1, B would have to be 1 over 3, which doesn't make sense at all, because that's not even an integer. So this is obviously not an R. So since all of these are for all statements, that is that. So since reflexive is a for all statement, we've shown one example where it breaks. Therefore, the whole thing can't be true. So that means we're done. This is not reflexive. All right? So since it's not reflexive, can it be an equivalence relation or a partial ordering relation? No, because you need reflexive for both of those. So we're done. Done with that problem. All right. So let's do a different relation. Let's let the relation be ordered pairs AB, still on integers. All right. Where A is greater than 2B or B is greater than 2A. So that means B would have to be less than A, obviously. So, yeah, there's just no way for these two to be equal. Let's pick one example. Let's pick zero. Let's pick 0, 0. For 0, 0, is 0 greater than 0? Is 0 greater than 0? No. So this 0, 0 obviously can't be an R. That's just one example of an integer where this breaks. Therefore, it's not reflexive. Such that, again, integers where A is equal to 0 mod B, or B is equivalent, congruent to 0 mod A. All right, so you've got either A is 0 mod B, or B is 0 mod A. Okay? Is R reflexive? How can you prove R is reflexive or not reflexive? What was that? Okay. Since reflexive is a for all statement, we would obviously disprove it with an example. That'd be the easiest way to disprove a for all statement. It always is. So let's just try some numbers. Let's try 0, 0. Okay, what's 0 mod 0? 0. Okay. And 0 mod 0 is obviously, again, 0. So that's an R. But 1, 1. What's 1 mod 1? Zero. 2 mod 2, is that 0? It's also 0. Does anyone sort of vaguely remember? You could just program it. Everyone should probably not program it, right? If you wanted to program something such that, you know, something happens on an even number, you would do like variable x mod 2 equals what? 0. If you wanted to find out something with odd, you'd use 0, whatever mod 2 equals 1. If x mod 2 equals 0, then it's even. So if you plug in 2 into there, you get 0, right? I don't know what sign I'm trying to get. Anything odd itself is 0. That should be something that at least has intuitive to them. Anything mod itself is 0. Alright? So we sort of know that, but how can we prove it mathematically the way that we have to in this class? Who has an idea just how to start? Yeah, we can just say anything mod itself is 0. We'll say that mathematically, the way that we have these symbols and stuff that we have to. Alright? So, for all A in Z, A mod A is equal to 0. Right? That's what you said, right? Forever A, A is an R. Thus, it's reflexive. Okay? So it's reflexive. Alright. strategy before for seeing if it was one or the other. Plug things in. It might be a good place to start, right? Because these are for all sins. It's the easiest way to disprove them is with a simple example. So hopefully, if you choose some smart test cases, you'll figure out if it is not symmetric really quickly. All right. What do we want to test first? Someone just got something else, right? 2-1. Cool. All right. So, 2 mod 1 is equal to what? So this is an R, obviously. For it to be symmetric, what also has to be an R? 1, 2. Alright, so what's 1 mod 2? One mod 2 is 1. So since it's not 0, this can't be an R, right? This can't be a part of the relation. Not symmetric. We've proven for 1, found 1 where it doesn't work, right? Therefore, it's not symmetric. But can I have an OR statement? Oh, it does have an OR statement. Oh, you're right. Be lazy and remove this problem later. If I didn't complete it, I just did it wrong. Yeah, because not that OR statement, you're right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're right. Good way of looking at it, good way of intuitively looking at it. Now I've just sort of got a hopefully on an exam, it would be, is this, what is this, let all that fly or something, and then you think you wouldn't have to prove it, but let's prove it. I would prove that it is symmetric then. Okay, I can see this. Say something like this. You can just do the reverse. Like that. So that's case one, where it becomes a relation because A mod B. Right? Case two would be AB is an R because B mod A. Thus, EA is an R because E mod A is equal to 0. Let me just choose that one. Okay, I kind of does it. Alright, so that is symmetric. problems that are partial proof, hopefully, you know, just plug each part in and see which one works. And you probably break it down to, well, these two work. You got to decide between those. Make an educated guess. Or make a non-educated, make an educated non-guess. So since it's symmetric, then obviously it can't be anti-symmetric. Yeah, it is symmetric. Yeah. I'm going to delete the other half of the problem to prove that as if it was just A mod B, not B mod A. For right now, we're doing both. I'm going to delete part of the problem later. It's going to be a different problem though, than this, just because I don't want to retype everything. Okay. Good thing you guys are here. You get a minute's problem, I mean. Alright. Is it transitive? Is it transitive? So that's R is equal to, you rewrite it. Okay. It's good you question things like these because your professor is human too, just like me, so he's probably going to make mistakes. So, pretty much like you said, I just guess and check for a few tries because it's pretty easy to disprove. Then if it doesn't seem like it's working out, then it probably is true. So we'll see, maybe think about why it's true. So for transitive, is it true? What can we plug in to try and see if it's true? Okay, so if we have 0, 1 being an R, let's pick something else that starts with 1 being an R. 1, 2. Does that imply that 0, 2 is an R? Okay. So first of all, can we prove that 0, 2 is an R? Well, 0, 1, 2 is what? Transitive in this case. Anyone see any cases where like this wouldn't happen for some reason? Okay. Okay, let's try a 4. Is that an R? Well, 4 mod 1 is an R because anything mod 1 is 0. Let's not use 1, 0. Let's use something else. Let's use 8. 4 and 8. Well, obviously we're going to do 8 mod 4 because 4 mod 8 is 4. We can do 8 and 16. Let's do 4 powers of 2. Alright, well, if we do 16 mod 8, we get 0, right? So now let's transpose that and get 16 mod 4. What's that? There we go. probably transitive. How are we going to prove that it's transitive? Okay. Well, 4 is definitely an R because 12 mod 4 is 0 because this is a multiple. 8 and 4 is an R. Let's do 4-8. It doesn't matter because we know it's reflexive, but let's do it this way anyway. Mm. 4-8 is an R. So let's. Yeah, well, proving true X, you've done. Yeah, good job. Job, Dan. You're trying to prove it true, but to prove it true, you thought of an example and just proving it false. That's pretty cool. Yeah. All right. So it's not transitive. Does that mean it's interquivalence relation? Does that mean it's a partial order relation? Okay. So we're done. This isn't an evil thing. All right. 15 minutes left, and we have just one left. One's kind of a lot more general, but so we've got some function. We don't really know exactly what it does, but we know that f of a is equal to f of b. So we'll take a look at that, think about whether it's reflexive or not, and all that stuff. And I've got some things we need to test out. some solutions to all of these. Except maybe the last one. Yeah, I'll be on my ucfsi.wordpress.com. Navigate to CECS, enter through the screen with Jarrett, and there you will find, the solutions to this review and all the past reviews. Is this reflexive? Yes? Why do you say it's reflexive? Okay. So I actually proved this sort of with a, I think it's a proof by contraposition. So if we assume. Assume that's not an R, okay? And that would mean that would imply F of A is not equal to F of A. I wrote that really poorly. Alright? Which just means that this is a poorly defined function. Itself doesn't equal itself, right? That's like no mathematical function in contiguous math will ever do that. You can write a function program that does that, you know, it returns the time, the current time. Or random value, right? So you can make a program that does that, that has a function, and there's some sort of space where those programs would equal some type of. There is a type of math that this would be true, it's called programming. Real math, which is what we're doing here, it doesn't work out. So that means by composition, it has to be reflexive. Alright? Is it? No, it's not. It's just, it just smears it around. Alright. What about transitive? Is it transitive? The relation going on between these functions is itself equivalence, right? So that means if you think about what this relation is, it's relating things because of equivalence. This function could be like x squared. Could be. Or else at x squared times 2 even. Right? So you could have like, you know, f of 1 equals f of negative 1, right? So 1, negative 1 are going to be in the relation. Yeah, it should be because the equivalence operator itself is an equivalent relation. is that you should be able to look at that and say, okay, it's obviously a performance relation without even looking at any of the things individually. It's okay if you don't, because like everything else has to take practice. Alright? And even if you are good at it, we have to prove it explicitly now. So we're done with joins. Alright. Is it symmetric? AB being R implies that F of A has a particular mass. Alright, F of A being equal to F of B, because you can flip things on the equal sign and you haven't changed the meaning of the whole line. So it is alright, because it's all of these, it's an equivalence relation. Alright. Everyone good on this? I did have one last problem. It's the first problem out of my review. So basically, we're definitely not going to be able to finish this problem because it's longer than it looks. You've learned a lot of symbols this semester, right? Like a ton of symbols, mathematical symbols that you didn't know existed. You think you can list them all and see what they're all used for? That's what that is for, yeah. We got a little bit of time. We got like, 7 minutes? So we can go through a few of these. So in my solution for this, I've got the easy ones, AND, OR, XOR, and stuff like that. Let's talk about mod as a symbol, sort of, it's like a function, let's call it a symbol for now, versus mod. Did anyone know that there's a difference between those two? Who can explain the difference between these two? Okay. So, I think you kind of know it. So, the first one is the function, alright? So, think the mod operator, the percent sign, you see. It's the exact same thing. So, if you take, 4 mod 3, that equals, 1? That's how that works. But here, instead, you would say that if you use the mod in parentheses, then instead you would say that 4 is equivalent to 1 mod 3. And you could even say that that's equivalent to 7. So if it's in parentheses, it applies to the entire line of connected congruent symbols. That's the only thing on this. It's like this symbol means congruent to. Yeah. Basically, you don't have to rewrite the mod every time. If you want to just express that using the one version without parentheses, the correct way to do that would be. Oh, it's these. oh no,